Greetings, Mustangs. It's great to be back again to talk to you about music from another decade. This week we'll be learning about music from the 1930s. 1930s were a very different time than the jazz age, the roaring 20s. The biggest event that affected the music of the 1930s was the Great Depression. What was the Great Depression? From History.com. The Great Depression was the worst economic downturn in the history of the industrialized world, lasting from 1929 to 1939. After the stock market crash of October 1929, consumer spending and investment dropped. Failing companies laid off workers. By 1933, when the Great Depression reached its lowest point, some 15 million Americans were unemployed, and nearly half the country's banks had failed. We won't get into the details of the Great Depression too much. I don't want to steal that lesson from some future history teacher you'll have. But suffice it to say that it was a time of extreme financial hardship for most Americans. Many people didn't have jobs. Families struggled to put food on the table. Many had to wait in long lines at community soup kitchens to get something to eat. And it wasn't a temporary situation. It lasted for over 10 years. These hard times impacted every part of American life. The arts and culture of the 1930s reflect this greater struggle. Radio had become the most popular form of entertainment. About 90% of homes had a radio by the end of the decade. Jazz had grown, both in popularity and also in the size of the bands. What used to be a small three-person jazz group became a big jazz band with many players. This new genre became known as big band music. Some big band artists to emerge in this time include Glenn Miller, Duke Ellington, and Benny Goodman. Musicians started to use the term swing to describe a certain style of jazz that eventually became a genre all its own. Jazz also continued in its own vein. Billie Holiday and Ella Fitzgerald were popular jazz singers of this time. In addition to jazz and swing, you could tune in to hear your favorite crooners on the radio. Crooners were male singers that sang pop and jazz standards. Singers like Rudy Valley and Bing Crosby were particularly famous. Here's a clip of Bing Crosby singing "Brother, Can You Spare a Dime?" A perfect reflection of how people were feeling at that time.
Once I built a railroad, I made it run, made it race against time. Once I built a railroad, now it's done. Brother, can you spare a dime?
Finally, radio shined a spotlight on regional music from the Appalachian Mountains, known as hillbilly music. These folk songs were made more famous by groups like the Carter Family and on broadcasts like the Grand Ole Opry. Based in Nashville, Tennessee, the Grand Ole Opry has continued broadcasting what we now call country music weekly since that time.
From Nashville, Tennessee, comes your Grand Ole Opry.
But perhaps the most important radio event of the 1930s was not a music broadcast. It was Orson Welles' War of the Worlds. Orson Welles was a radio host with a weekly hour-long program on CBS, the Mercury Theater on the air. On Halloween night in 1938, his program featured an adaptation of H.G. Wells' novel, War of the Worlds. The show started with an introduction telling people it was an adaptation of this famous story about an alien invasion. Then the program itself started. It sounded like a typical music program until fake newscasters interrupted the program to announce strange gas explosions on Mars.
9:15 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Seismograph registered shock of almost earthquake intensity occurring within a radius of 20 miles of Princeton. Please investigate. Signed, Lloyd Gray, Chief of Astronomical Division.
The music came back, only to be interrupted again by another announcement of a meteor crash in Grover's Mill, New Jersey. The story escalated into an all-out warfare between the United States of America and the Martians.
The top blue!
Look out there! Stand back! Look
ladies
back.
And gentlemen, this is the most terrifying thing I've ever witnessed. Wait a minute. Someone crawling
someone
out of
or something I can see tearing out of that black hole, two luminous disks.
Of course, this was fiction meant to entertain. However, people tuning in a few minutes late missed the announcement that this was a dramatization of a novel and thought it was a real newscast. Panic ensued across the country as some people got so scared they started fleeing for their lives. Eventually, word got out that it was a story and not real news, but not before it became the most famous radio broadcast in the history of radio. One of the biggest impacts of the Great Depression on entertainment was the increased popularity of motion pictures. As tickets to live theater performances became too expensive for most people to afford, the now bustling and also now talking movie industry offered a cheaper way to be entertained. Movie theaters quickly saw the opportunity for growth and offered weekly movie passes with a fixed price for as many movies as a person wanted to see in a week. The most popular types of movies included gangster movies, as well as comedies like The Marx Brothers and The Three Stooges, and dramas. Westerns also joined the movie mainstream in the 1930s. John Wayne was the most famous actor in Western movies and was known for playing the hero cowboy. Gene Autry and Roy Rogers took it a step further and took on roles as singing cowboys. And with people going to see live theater less, they enjoyed movie musicals more. The most famous actors in musicals in the 1930s were Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers. From 1933 to 1939, they were in 9 movies together. They were perfect examples of the triple threat: actors, singers, and dancers. Here's part of a dance they performed in their best-loved musical, Swing Time. Other famous musicals of the 1930s included the first feature-length Disney movie, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, 42nd Street, and, of course, The Wizard of Oz.
Madam Suffolk, I'm afraid you've made rather a bad enemy of the Wicked Witch of the West. The sooner you get out of Oz altogether, the safer you sleep, my dear.
Oh, I'd give anything to get out of Oz altogether.
The most epic movie of the 1930s, and possibly all time, was 1939's Gone with the Wind. Gone with the Wind was an epic historical romance film based on a book of the same name by Margaret Mitchell. It tells the story of Scarlett O'Hara, a plantation owner in Georgia, during and after the Civil War. Clocking in at just over 3 hours with credits and intermission, I'm not sure I'd recommend it for most elementary audiences, but it is an important piece of film history, and the main piece of music, Tara's theme, is iconic. Music was one of the most important ways people distracted themselves from the troubles of their day-to-day lives in the 1930s. People found more ways to enjoy that music and new ways of making it, too. Now it's your turn. Here are some optional assignments for you. Number 1. Make your own radio show. Create and read a script, sing or play a song, come up with some fun sound effects or whatever else sounds fun to you. I'd love to hear your show. Number 2. Learn a dance from the 1930s. The Lindy Hop, named after the famous pilot Charles Lindbergh, became known as the Jitterbug in the 1930s. Learn the basic swing step that is the jumping off point for dancing the Jitterbug. You'll find the tutorial video in my YouTube playlist. Invite someone in your family to learn with you if you like. Or you can wait until the next time we see each other, and I'll be happy to do the Jitterbug with you. Option number 3. Watch a 1930s musical. You might want to watch one of the many Ginger Rogers and Fred Astaire movies. Swing Time is their most popular movie. Or maybe you prefer The Wizard of Oz. You could also opt for a movie made later but set in the 1930s. Annie. Our family loved watching Singing in the Rain last week, and we'll pick one of these for us this week as well. Well, that's it for this lesson. I'll see you next week when we talk about music from the 1940s. Until then, take care and stay well. Miss you.